Good, then let's start with statistics for data science. Good morning, everyone. The topic today are confidence intervals, so a fairly common topic in frequent statistics, and something that is, of course, of high applied value, as confidence intervals will be encountered in many scientific and research studies, and they're just a very common thing. So yeah, a core aspect of frequentist inference, and forming actually a two session unit together with hypothesis testing. At the end of the hypothesis testing session, we will discuss the equivalence of confidence intervals in hypothesis tests, so how you can create a hypothesis test based on a confidence interval, and how you can create confidence intervals based on hypothesis tests. So they are closely connected, and that's then actually also the final part of the frequentist inference aspects of this course. So the plan for today is to first discuss four selected statistics, because we need a little bit of small sample and large sample distribution theory for these applications, because otherwise it's really hard to do examples. And this will be kind of an interlude, and we will use these selected statistics both in the confidence interval session and the hypothesis testing session. So that will be a short preliminary part, and then we're going to discuss confidence intervals, and we will first establish some background and some basic theory, and then look at examples both for exact confidence intervals and approximate confidence intervals, and then there will be some exercises. But before we go into confidence intervals, we need to review a few very common statistics in frequentist statistics. And these are the Z-statistic, T-statistic, the U-statistic, and the Wahl statistic. And I will present all of them essentially in theorem form. And we have in part established proofs for the results that I'm showing you. I also prompt you to a reference in the Casella book. Maybe in future iterations of the course I will devote a full session to this. The thing is, these are very fundamental results that you encounter again and again. To establish them is almost more, or it doesn't really add that much with respect to the results, so that's why I don't really devote a full session to them these days. But yeah, in part we have seen actually proofs of what I'm talking about here in theorem form. So the aim now for the next like 10 minutes or so is to introduce these selected statistics, so Z, U, T, and Wahl statistic, but again without proof. It's just important knowledge about the distribution of statistics in a small sample, usually Gaussian setting, except for the Wahl statistic, and it's just basic knowledge, which, however, can of course be mathematically much more grounded than I'm doing it here. Although, as I already said, we have some parts of the proofs already established in the lecture on transformations. So, what are these statistics? The first statistic that we are going to need for hypothesis testing and confidence intervals is the Z-statistic. So let me remind you of the scenario. So we have n normally distributed random variables with expectation parameter mu and variance parameter sigma square. Of course they are IID, because we consider them a random sample, and we have the sample mean x bar, is the average of these random variables. Then the Z statistic is defined as follows. Z is a random variable which is defined as the square root of n divided by the standard deviation, which obviously you need to know if you want to compute this. Times the sample mean, and from the sample mean you subtract the expectation. And this Z statistic is distributed according to a standard normal distribution. So like we always did in kind of simulations, if you sample n Gaussian random variables and then you take your data points and you basically put them through a function that applies this expression here, then the result, this random variable Z, is standard normally distributed, meaning it has mean 0 and variance 1. And a PDF of this is of course the standard normal PDF, which is just the Gaussian PDF, univariate Gaussian PDF without the sigma square, or for which sigma square is 1 and for which mu is 0. And what we will also need, especially when we introduce confidence intervals, are the corresponding CDFs and inverse CDFs. So remember that the CDF refers to the probability that the random variable takes on values smaller or equal to some value, and that the inverse CDF returns for a given probability the respective value in the outcome space of the random variable, and we will denote them by phi and phi minus 1. And we've seen this essentially under the label of Z transformation when we discussed Gaussian transformations, and here is a reference for a proof if you want another kind of development of this. The U statistic is relating to the sample variance. Again, we assume that we have a Gaussian random sample, and we denote the sample mean by x bar, and we denote the sample variance by s square n. Sample variance, like previously introduced, the sum of squared deviations from the sample mean divided by n minus 1. We define here the U statistic as the sample variance multiplied by n minus 1 and divided by the true but unknown variance. Again, this statistic here, so if you sample from a Gaussian and then evaluate the sample variance, for which you of course need the sample mean, and then multiply by n minus 1 divided by sigma square, then this random variable is distributed according to a chi-squared distribution with n minus degrees of freedom. And we looked at chi-squared distribution previously, and we also looked at the fact that chi-squared distributions are the distributions of squared normal random variables, which is of course something that we have here, and we establish actually the PDF or chi-square distribution for n degrees of freedom, and here we have the n minus 1 degrees of freedom. We denote the associated CDF and inverse CDF by xi, that's a big xi square, and xi square minus 1, where I omit that we of course need to take care of the degrees of freedom. So the U statistic may be something that you haven't seen. It's just something that we will need later on if we do confidence intervals or hypothesis tests regarding the variance of a Gaussian. Finally, something that you definitely have seen before is the T statistic, where we of course first need the sample mean and the sample standard deviation as the square root of the sample variance, and then the t statistic is defined as the ratio between the sample mean minus the expected value of the Gaussian divided by the standard deviation and multiplied by the square root of the sample size. And this t statistic is distributed according to a t distribution with n minus 1 degrees of freedom. We established the T distribution already in lecture 5 as the ratio of a standard normal random variable and the square root of a chi-square random variable divided by its degrees of freedom. And we also shown its PDF. What we haven't shown and what we will look at as in a short way in theoretical exercise 1 is that this definition here of the t-statistic actually conforms to this ratio of a standard normal random variable and the square root of a chi-square random variable divided by its degrees of freedom. This is what we will look at. But if this is the case, so if this t-statistic can actually be written as such, and the degrees of freedom of this chi-squared random variable are in fact n minus 1, then it follows directly that the t-statistic has this PDF. And there's a typo because there's a, so on the previous slide as well, there's an equal sign or a definition. Well, we can use an equal sign here, an equal sign missing. So these are core statistics in Gaussian random sample theory, the Z statistic, and its associated distribution, the U statistic, and its associated distribution, and the T statistic, and we will make use of them in this session on confidence intervals and in the next session on hypothesis testing, and we've seen parts of their development already. There is one more statistic that we will need, which derives from this asymptotic considerations that we discussed last week. Namely the so-called Wald statistic. Here we assume that we have a random sample with PDF p theta, but not specified what kind of distribution we are dealing with, and we have the case that we have a maximum likelihood estimator, and we use IN and JN at the location of the maximum likelihood estimator to denote the observed Fisher information and the observed expected Fisher information of the random sample. I think when I introduced Fisher information, I did definitely introduce observed Fisher information, and I did introduce expected Fisher information. Sometimes the expected expected Fisher information, depending on how it comes about, can also depend on the parameter value, and then you also have something that I call here the observed expected Fisher information. We actually saw an example for that last week with the Bernoulli random variable, so that's the expected Fisher information. At the location of the maximum likelihood estimator, you can also, and this is how Wassermann does it, call then this observed expected Fisher information, where you substitute the maximum likelihood estimator for the unknown parameter. You might also call that an estimator for the expected Fisher information. So depends a little bit, I guess, on how you view it. But if these things are given, then we define two Wald statistics, and we are mainly interested in actually in the second Wald statistic, this WJN, as the square root of the expected observed Fisher information at the location of the maximum likelihood estimator times the maximum likelihood estimator minus the true but unknown parameter. And these Wald statistics, as we introduced, or as we discussed last week in this relatively long proof with the couple of errors in there, these Wald statistics are asymptotically normally distributed according to standard normal distributions. So WJN is asymptotically normally distributed according to univariate Gaussian with expectation parameter 0 and variance parameter 1. And hence they have the typical PDF of a, or they have the PDF of a univariate of a standard normal distribution, And again, we denote the CDFs and inverse CDFs by phi and phi minus 1, like we do, of course, for the set distribution, because it's the same distribution. The only difference is that this, so that in this case, the standard normal distribution is the asymptotic distribution of this statistic. And here's a prompt to the proofs. Of course, we looked at this in some detail in lecture 10. So these are the four statistics that will come up. So again, we have the Z statistic with its standard normal distribution. We have the U statistic with its chi-square distribution with n minus degree n minus 1 degrees of freedom. We have the T statistic with its T distribution with n minus 1 degrees of freedom. And we have the Wald statistic with the standard normal distribution. And all of these statistics, of course, and this is why I make this big fuss about transformations, all of these distributional results, of course, just result from the transformation of random variables. You start with these n random variables, of which you know the distribution, then you apply functions, in this case you apply this function here to the random sample, and then you study the resulting probability density. And so, of course, these are just very common models, but of course statistics is not limited to Gaussian models. They are just very common, but if you develop your own confidence intervals or hypothesis test for a different distributional scenario, then of course you can apply the same ideas. You start with defining a random sample, and then you apply a function, and then you try to figure out the probability density function of your statistics, that statistic that you evaluated by means of your function. Good, but these are basic results that you of course also find in all books on statistics, and will be results that we will use for the examples in confidence intervals and in hypothesis testing. Okay, are there any questions regarding these selected statistics? Apparently not. Then I suggest that we then start with the actual topic, or the main topic for today, namely confidence intervals. And yeah, these are the references. So I follow the help book quite a lot. And the Wassermann book comes in with respect to approximate confidence intervals, and I use a little bit of my old texts on statistics from my math studies in Hagen for the examples, because they are nicely spelled out there. Okay, so confidence intervals. First, the question is, what are confidence intervals, how they should be interpreted, or how they can be interpreted based on the definition, and the notion of a pivot. This is the first part. And of course, this whole thing about confidence intervals is tightly situated in the standard problems of frequentist inference that we've been studying for a number of weeks now. So of course, one topic that we dealt with up to now essentially exclusively is parameter estimation. So point parameter estimation, to find a best guess for the true but unknown parameter value of the model, typically based on the observation of a random sample. So we've done that quite extensively. We looked at various methods to derive parameter estimates, and we looked at various criteria to evaluate the quality of estimators. The next standard problem is what we're actually looking at today, confidence interval evaluation, to provide a quantitative uncertainty statement about a parameter estimate based on the parameter estimated sampling distribution. Of course, the key in confidence intervals is to clearly dissociate them from credible intervals that we will see in Bayesian statistics, and to get the interpretation right in confidence intervals. The next and the last thing in frequentist inference that we will look at is hypothesis testing, so to decide whether the true but unknown parameter is in one of two mutually exclusive subsets of parameter space, which is the topic of next week. And in general, that's interesting. Confidence interval evaluation and hypothesis testing make extensive use of statistics and their distribution properties. Hence, I introduced some statistics before we started this. This is again my little figure, so that you're clear about what's going on. So in the world, there's the true but unknown parameter value. It's fixed. In point estimation, we come up with a point estimate as our best guess. And as I previously explained, the probability for being wrong is essentially one if you think about the real numbers. So you're very precise in your statement, but the likelihood for being wrong is also quite large. In a confidence interval statement, you make a statement roughly about where in parameter space the true but unknown parameter may be located, although one needs to be careful with the interpretation there. And there, of course, the statement is less precise because one is talking about an interval, but also more likely to be correct. So we will have a look at what is called delta confidence intervals, and the delta is usually in the 95%, so the certainty is larger. And hypothesis testing estimates is a statement about the part or subspace of parameter space in which the true but unknown parameter may fall. And here one can actually, although it's it might sound even less or it is less precise in terms of depends, but it's sounds even coarser in terms of the statement, the probabilities are often the same as in confidence intervals, as we will see when we look at the equivalence of confidence intervals in hypothesis testing. So that's the rough overview. And we are now leaving the point estimate business and the evaluation of point estimators and go to confidence intervals. And again, of course, this whole thing unfolds on the background of the frequentist sampling intuition. Of course, we're still in frequentist statistics, so we have our random sample. Observed data is considered one possible realization of the random sample, and from the frequentist perspective, we can of course sample n data points many times, which I denoted here by superscript 1, superscript 2, superscript 3, 4, and 5, and so on. And for each of those, we can evaluate a statistic, which I denote here by h. Remember that the only difference between estimators and statistics is that estimators take on values in the parameter space of the statistical parametric model, where statistics usually don't. They take on values in the outcome space of the statistic, but both of them are just functions of the data, and hence of the random variables modeling the data, and hence also the distinction between estimators and statistics is not that strong. Here's a typo. This is of course a 5 as well. And as for estimators in frequentist inference, we are interested in the distributional properties of statistics, and we just studied that or looked at that for the z-statistic, t-statistic, u-statistic, and wall statistic. And these were statistics that were basically evaluated as two real numbers. What we will here be looking at when we talk about confidence intervals is statistics in the form of intervals. So we have here a closed interval, and I just wrote up something here. So if we have a data point x1 to xn, what is the distribution of the sample mean minus twice the standard deviation divided by the square root of n to the sample mean plus twice the sample standard deviation divided by the square root of n. So what are the distributions of these intervals given that we sample repeatedly from the underlying statistical parametric models? So again, the important point, or what I want to stress here, is that we are talking about sampling distributions that result from sampling data again and again, and then forming statistics that may take different forms in these in this setting, and they take the form of intervals. Next week we will see we talk about the distribution of tests, which are random variables that take on binary values, so 0 and 1, so reject null hypothesis, don't reject null hypothesis. So we are always talking about sampling data repeatedly and applying a function and studying how the result or the value of this function, either a number like in estimators, an interval like in confidence intervals, or the result of a test are distributed. This is what frequentist inference is interested in. Yeah. So that was background. I don't know why this slide is coming up again. In any case, here now the definition of the delta confidence interval. So after this little intro, let's define a confidence interval. So we assume that we have a parametric statistical model P with PMF or PDF P theta, and we have a sample which we denote by X, and the sample of course comprises n IID random variables distributed according to the PMF or PDF P theta, and we take a delta in the open interval from 0 to 1, typically delta being on the upper end, so something like 0.95. And we take two statistics, namely BL of X and BU of X. So these are functions of the random sample, and BL denotes a lower boundary, and BU denotes an upper boundary, as we will see in a second. So if we define all of this, and then a delta confidence interval is an interval that we denote by CN, with a lower boundary BL and upper boundary BU, such that the probability that the confidence interval contains the true but unknown parameter, that is, that the lower boundary is smaller or equal to the true but unknown parameter theta, and the upper boundary is larger or equal to the true but unknown parameter theta, is equals delta for all parameter in the parameter space. And this delta is called the confidence level or coverage probability, and the random variables BLX and BUX are the lower and upper bounds of the confidence interval. So the crucial thing in confidence intervals is to keep track of what is random and what is not random. What is random are the upper and lower boundaries of the interval, hence the interval. What is not random is the true but unknown parameter. So we don't discuss probabilities of the parameter, we discuss the probability that a confidence interval covers the true but unknown parameter. And maybe first some remarks here, and then one thing that is also a little bit crucial is first CN, so the confidence interval, is a random interval because its lower and upper boundaries are random variables. So if you sample new data, you get a new confidence interval based on the formula that you use for BL and BU, but because you plug in a different random sample, if there's some randomness in the observations of the data, then you get another confidence interval. Theta is the true but unknown parameter, is not random and unknown. The delta confidence interval covers the true theta with probability delta. Yeah, often delta is 0.95, which is then referred to as a 95% confidence interval. We've also seen this. We can have something called one-sided confidence intervals, although we will, I think, not discuss them in the examples. These would have a lower boundary of minus infinity and upper boundary of infinity. And one thing that may help to think about the confidence intervals is to write this confidence condition in this form. I just put it in this morning, so what I really should do is here put a little theta in there, and maybe also then say this is equal to delta. What is a little bit confusing, but this is how you see this always, you see the probability here of an event, namely that the true but unknown parameter is in the confidence interval. One is quite used to seeing these statements, but then the random entity is here on the left, so something like x equals 4 or something. So one has, based on this, on writing it like this, there's a little bit of a prediction error or mismatch, because one thinks that theta may be the random thing, but it's Cn which is the random thing, which has only to do with the order of how things are written. So it may help to write that Cn is a superset of the true but unknown parameter, or actually we might also just of course here write the reverse element of a symbol in there, so that it's clearer, because that's how it's usually written, that the Cn is the random entity here, and this is just a value that it may or may not contain. However, in the literature you find it this way all the time, but this of course is easily then conflated with your typical writing of how random variables are distributed. So again, Cn is random, theta is a value. Yeah? So this may be better actually to write. So that's the definition, and of course the definition by itself is fine, but we really need to look at examples to get this clearer. Before we look at examples, two interpretations. So first is we consider an experiment and we repeat this over and over. Then the delta confidence interval will contain the true but unknown parameter in delta times 100% of all cases. So this is basically what I've been mainly framing things like so far. So more technically, for repeated random samples from a distribution with unknown parameter theta, delta confidence interval will cover theta in delta times 100% of all cases. That's one way one can look at it, and which is completely fine. But of course, it's also not really what happens in practice, because usually in practice you will not repeat and repeat the same experiment again and again with the same true but unknown parameter value. But you do one experiment and you might report confidence intervals, and then you do something completely different and you again use confidence intervals. But it's actually also completely fine to think about confidence intervals like this. So you consider sequence of experiments with unrelated parameters theta 1, theta 2, and you imagine constructing delta confidence intervals for the sequence of unrelated parameters theta 1, theta 2, then delta times 100% of the confidence intervals will contain the true but unknown parameter value, which is just the case because, of course, if you consider this here to be one of these experiments, then if you would repeat it with theta 1, there's a 5% chance that the confidence interval does not contain the true but unknown parameter. And this may happen with 5% chance on your first on this experiment, but again that's the same for theta 2 and so on. So they so the probability statement that you have for the fixed theta then also applies to these different thetas. It's just that the second, so that's a point made by Wassermann, the second interpretation is a little bit closer to what happens actually in applied scenarios. But yeah, if you are happy with this on first approximation, then you are of course completely fine. Finally, before we can look at examples, it's helpful to introduce this notion of pivots, which in the abstract form sounds a little bit weird, but if we then look at examples it's actually getting quite clear what is meant by that. An exact pivot is, and pivots are used in the construction of confidence intervals, so an exact pivot is a function of the data and the true but unknown parameter theta with a distribution not depending on theta. And we've already seen that. So for example, if you think about the t value that I introduced this morning, then this t value is of course a function of the data, because the sample mean and the sample standard deviation are required to evaluate the t value, and it's also a function of the true but unknown parameter theta, because you need to subtract mu from the sample mean to evaluate the t-statistic. But the distribution of the t-statistic does not depend on the true but unknown parameter, because that's the t-distribution with n minus degrees of freedom. So it's does not depend on the value of mu, which is due to the fact that you subtracted actually in the evaluation of the t-statistic itself. And these, if you have these kind of things with them, so with pivots, you can easily create confidence intervals, as we will see then in examples. And an approximate pivot is a pivot whose distribution does not asymptotically depend on the true parameter, and this will of course be important for the construction of approximate confidence interval. So I wrote it up here a couple of times more to let that sink in. So a pivot is a statistic depending on the true theta with the distribution independent of theta. Pivots can be used to construct intervals valid for all values of theta, because their distribution is independent of theta. Pivots should not depend on nuisance parameter eta. What that means we will see in examples. If there are nuisance parameter, the pivot's distribution must not depend on theta or eta, and we will see confidence intervals based on exact pivots that will we will call exact confidence intervals, and we will see confidence intervals based on approximate pivots, which we refer to as approximate confidence intervals. And typically exact and approximate pivots are the t and the Wald statistic, as I already mentioned. And why this notion of pivot is interesting and helpful is because, as we will see when we now construct confidence intervals, you will see that certain things need to be known and not known, and depending on something and not depending on something, to make this construction of confidence intervals work. So I will always on all slides refer back to this notion of pivot and spell out where this notion of pivot now comes in, so that it's getting clearer. Good. Yeah, maybe before the break, let's briefly discuss the principal approach to defining confidence intervals and creating confidence intervals, because the aim here is that you, of course, learn from example how to create confidence intervals, but then as a data scientist in a new scenario with new distributions, you are then able to construct confidence intervals yourself. And enable you to do that, I kind of formulated this constructive approach in kind of a recipe manner. This proceeds as follows. So first, of course, you need to define the parametric statistical model that you're dealing with. Of course, you can also do this in non-parametric statistics, but confidence intervals, but then, of course, that's not what we are covering in this course. You need to define a specific statistic and assess its distribution. Because you need to need something to work with, then you need to verify the confidence condition, so the coverage probability of your confidence interval with respect to the true but unknown parameter value. And once you have verified that, then one can just write down the confidence interval, and we will do this by example so that you see what is exactly meant by this. First for exact confidence intervals, and in these examples, namely an exact confidence interval for the expectation of a normal distribution with known variance. Always remember the confidence intervals are made for parameters, so they are kind of a coarser parameter estimates compared to point estimators. So we always we construct confidence intervals for parameters of parametric statistical models, and the parameters that we're interested in is the expectation of a normal distribution with known variance first, then the expectation of a normal distribution with unknown variance, and finally the variance of a normal distribution. And once we've done that, we will look into approximate confidence intervals. But before we start that, let's take a break. Are there any questions right now? Okay, then let's take a break and continue at 8:30. Okay, then let us look at some examples for confidence intervals based on the recipe for their construction that I introduced before the break. So we first look at and define the statistical model that we're dealing with, then we look at a specific statistic and its distribution, and then actually the confidence interval construction proper starts by verifying the confidence condition and formulating the confidence interval. So the first confidence interval that we're looking at here is a confidence interval for the expectation parameter of a normal distribution under the assumption that the variance is known. And here we assume the following parametric statistical model. It's fairly standard, of course. We have n independent and identically distributed random variables according to a Gaussian with expectation parameter mu and variance parameter sigma square. And we assume that we know sigma square, which is of course just an assumption here, and we relax that already in the next example. And we assume that the expectation parameter mu is unknown, and what we want to do is now develop a delta confidence interval for mu. And the statistic that we are considering for this purpose is the z statistic, the same z statistic that we introduced in the last hour in the beginning. And this is defined as the square root of the number of samples divided by the true but unknown standard deviation parameter, or square root of the Schubert unknown variance parameter times the sample mean minus the expectation. And so we define the statistic here and its distribution we have already established as being standard normally distributed. And now relating to this notion of pivot or pivots, the z-statistic is of course a function of the random sample by means of the sample mean and also the true but unknown expectation parameter. But its distribution does not depend on mu, and sigma square is sigma and sigma square are known. And because it's a function of the data and the true but unknown parameter, but its distribution does not depend on the true but unknown parameter, it's a pivot, and it's exact because it's not asymptotically not depending on mu, but always not depending on mu. Now, how, based on this, was essentially just a statistic in this parametric statistical model, how now to create a confidence interval. To this end, we first need to define our delta level by selecting a delta in the open interval 0 to 1. And then we select two percentiles of the distribution of the statistic, so our standard normal distribution, such that between these percentiles, so these values in the outcome space of the random variable z or of the z statistic, we have a probability mass of delta. And of course, to achieve this, we figure out the percentile z1, which we get from the inverse CDF for 1 minus delta divided by 2. So what we're aiming for here is that we have a half of the probability mass outside of the confidence interval below the confidence interval and the other half above. So these kind of symmetric confidence intervals, of course, something that is very intuitive for the case of symmetric distributions, and hence we use it here. It's not the only way one can allocate the probability mass of confidence intervals, but we will use this way. So we want to make sure that between z1 and z2 the random variable z takes on values with probability 0.95, and hence we find the corresponding percentiles for the lower and the upper bound. So we define that one as the inverse CDF of 1 minus delta divided by 2, so that would be something like 0.25, and Z2 as 1 plus delta divided by 2, so that would be something like 0.97. So here's the example for delta 0.95, which is a typical confidence interval criterion. These statements here would refer to figuring out the value such that z takes on values below the value that we're dealing with probability 0.025, so 2.5%, and that z takes on values above the value z2 with probability 0.25. So we're looking at the percentile corresponding to 0.97, and that's 1.96. So if you think about the standard normal distribution, think of the values minus 1.96 and 1.96, and the probability density that is allocated to these tails of the distribution, then it's fairly obvious what these things here mean. However, I'm not making here little pictures and so on, because if you implement it, what you will need is the inverse CDF, and you need to specify your deltas. So this really allows you to easily implement things. And if you have a nice picture, then it's a nice picture to look at, but it's not necessarily clear how to implement this. Because the standard normal distribution is symmetric, Z1 equals minus Z2, which you can also appreciate from this example here with the delta 0.95. Now, because we select the percentiles as such, the probability for the statistic that we are dealing with to take on values between these two values is exactly delta, and that's merely by construction, right? So we selected a delta, and then we figured out the two values such that such that the probability for the statistic to take on values between these two values is exactly delta. And this just follows from applying, of course, the machinery of CDF and inverse CDFs. So not much has happened. We just said, okay, we have a distribution, and we now want to find two values such that the statistic that has this distribution has a probability of delta to fall between these two values. So not much has really happened. This is all defined as soon as you define and as soon as you evaluate or have the distribution of the statistic. Now, basically what we can say from this is that the probability for the z-statistic to take on values, for example, between minus 1.96 and 1.96 is 0.95. That's fine, but it has nothing to do much with confidence intervals. It's just how probability theory works, essentially. But now we can use this and the fact that that is a pivot to construct a confidence interval. Because z is defined as the square root of n divided by sigma times the sample mean minus mu, and we want to construct a confidence interval for mu, so we want to have a statement of the form, let me show you that again, of the form, so our current theta is mu, that we have a lower boundary and upper boundary, and we want to ensure that the probability that this confidence interval contains theta is exactly delta. And because our z-statistic is a pivot in the z-statistic, it's depending on the true but unknown parameter, so we get that in there. And it's a function of the data, so it's a random variable, and we can then reformulate this confidence condition here. And this reformulation looks as follows. So first, obviously, we just substituted for z. And then what we do is we just multiply by sigma, so to get for both inequalities sigma on the other side. Then we just have xn minus mu in there, and then we subtract xn from both sides, so we have minus xn minus sigma divided by square root of n times z2 minus mu and minus sample mean plus sigma square root zn, so that's the pluses here because the z2 was positive and this was negative, hence here the minus. Now we have already a statement that is roughly in line with what we are looking for in a confidence interval, but we have not theta sandwiched between these two boundaries, which are random, because here the sample mean is random, this is random, but minus mu. So we multiply everything by minus 1, which then of course changes the signs here, but also the inequalities. Then is there something happening at all at this line? At this line, I think there's nothing happening, so we could also remove it. And then we just again flip what we have here, so mu larger or equal to xn minus sigma square square root n z2. So we just write this on the other side. So we have xn minus sigma divided by square root of n z2 is smaller than mu is smaller than xn, and we put this on the other side. And now we have constructed something with a random lower boundary and a random upper boundary, and the probability for these boundaries to sandwich the true but unknown parameter is delta, because this is just this expression here, and this was constructed to be delta in the first place. Now that's the confidence condition, and based on this we can now state the confidence interval. So for a random sample with no variance parameter sigma square and unknown expectation parameter mu delta, and the definition of z delta as the inverse CDF evaluated as 1 plus delta divided by 2. If you set Cn to be xn minus sigma divided by square root of n times z delta to the sample mean plus this expression that we also have here, then the probability for Cn to contain mu equals delta. And of course, again, this could be written as Cn including mu equals delta. And this is exactly then the definition of a confidence interval. And still be aware that because the sample mean is a random variable, this confidence interval is random. So this construction works, of course, because our pivot here depends on the true but unknown expectation parameters. So we can then reformulate it as a statement where the true but unknown expectation parameter is sandwiched. And because this is a function of the data and hence random. Hence, this is where this notion of pivot comes in. If you have a statistic that, for example, if you have a statistic where there's no mu, then you cannot reformulate such a statement and cannot get a confidence interval. So this is why this idea of a pivot is crucial in the construction of confidence intervals. So of course you can define many statistics, but if you want a statistic with which you can create a confidence interval for the true but unknown parameter, you need to make sure that the statistic is a function of the data, which it usually is, because otherwise it wouldn't be a statistic, but that also the true but unknown parameter comes in, and of course that you know the distribution of the statistic, because otherwise you cannot ensure this confidence interval, this confidence condition in the first place. Yuri, so that was the first example. Then let's immediately look at another example. Because it's exactly the same logic, but it helps to rehearse that a couple of times. So we now assume that we have a parametric statistical model that is of the same form, but we now assume that we have an unknown expectation parameter mu and an unknown variance parameter. So the more realistic scenario that we assume the data are normally distributed, but we don't know the expectation parameter and we don't know the variance parameter, and we want to develop a confidence interval for the expectation parameter. And to this end we consider the t-statistic, where of course the difference with respect to that statistic is that it's not based on the true but unknown square root of the variance parameter, but on the sample variance, and which is again written up here. And we again know that this t-statistic is distributed according to a t-distribution with n minus 1 degrees of freedom. Now, again, t is a function of the data, in this case by means of both the sample mean and the sample standard deviation. Here we should, for consistency, write as n. and its distribution does not depend on neither the two-bit unknown mu and sigma square. Sigma square is a nuisance parameter, so it's an unknown parameter, but t does not depend on it, because if it would depend on it and we don't know, then we cannot evaluate t, and its distribution also does not depend on sigma square, because the t distribution just depends on the degrees of freedom. Hence we have a exact pivot, and with this pivot we can construct a confidence interval. Now, the construction here is then complete an analogy to what we've seen before. So we select a delta, and again we find the percentiles such that the probability for the t distribution to fall between these, the probability for the t statistic to fall between these percentiles is delta, which again we can create by using the inverse CDF and allocating half of the probability mass that we want to exclude from our confidence interval below t1 and the other half above t1, such that the probability mass then included by bounded by lower bound by t1 and upper bound by t2 is exactly delta. Here is a concrete example. Of course, here in contrast to the z statistic, the distribution of the t statistic depends also on the degrees of freedom. So for n equals 10, we get, for example, for delta confidence confidence condition of 0.95, we get minus 2.26 to exclude 2.5% probability mass on the left, and 2.26 on the right, which has to do with, of course, the bigger tails of the t distribution. But again, we have a symmetric distribution, so here again our t1 equals minus t2. It's for this example minus and plus 2.26. Then again, just by based on the form of the distribution of the statistic and the selection of these upper and lower boundaries, the probability for the t statistic to take on values between minus t2 and t2 equals delta. That's not surprising, because minus t2 and t2 were selected exactly to achieve this. And then again, the fact that t is a pivot and comprises mu here for all of them, actually I should put a little n as a subscript just for consistency. Because it's an exact pivot, it depends on mu. So we can again use this fact to shuffle things around and sandwich then mu. And again, it of course depends on the data, and it does not depend on the unknown parameter sigma square. And yeah, doing this then follows the same logic as previously. First we put the s on the other side by multiplication. Then we put the xn on the other side, so that we have minus mu here. Then we have the same typo as previously, namely that nothing is happening in this line here. And we end up with the statement here that the probability for mu to be larger or equal to xn minus s divided by square root of n times t2 or smaller, and smaller than xn plus s divided by square root of n t2 equals delta, because that was how it was constructed in the first place. So again, we have a statement where we have a random lower boundary, a random upper boundary, and these boundaries include or sandwich the true but unknown parameter. Now, based on this, we can then formulate the confidence interval that for this random sample with unknown expectation parameter mu and unknown variance parameter. Oops, that's now the typos are really kicking in. Unknown variance parameter sigma square, of course. If we set our t delta as the inverse of the CDF of the t distribution appropriately, so for 0.25 on as 1 plus delta divided by 2, which of course depends on your delta. If we define the confidence interval with this random lower boundary and this random upper boundary, then the Cn covers mu with probability delta, which again is just a consequence of the fact that the t-distribution has a probability of delta for t to take on values between minus t2 and t2. And again, it's a random interval. Finally, the last exact confidence interval. Here we assume again Gaussian sample, but now we assume unknown variance parameter sigma square, and mu may be known or maybe not known, but what we want to do is to develop a delta confidence interval for sigma square. Now, to this end, we use the U statistic. The U statistic, as we saw a couple of minutes ago, is given by the sample variance multiplied by n minus 1 divided by sigma square, the sample variance you know, and we know that the U statistic is chi-square distributed, and again it's a pivot because it's a function of the data by means of the sample variance and sigma square. But its distribution does not depend on sigma square, because the distribution just depends on the degrees of freedom. So we again have a pivot and can use this to construct a confidence interval. And again, we do this by first selecting a delta and then selecting two percentiles such that the probability for u to fall between these two percentiles is exactly delta, and we again do this by means of the inverse CDF and distribute or make sure that 1 minus delta divided by 2, so for example 0.25, is to the left of C1, and 0.25 probability mass is to the right of C2. And here the examples are as follows, and this is maybe a little bit interesting to see with respect to the cases that we had before. You might remember that the chi-square distribution is not symmetric, and that it's of course the chi-square distribution as outcome space only has the positive numbers, so our two percentiles are also positive, so xc1 is 2.7 and xc2 is 19 for the case of 9 degrees of freedom and a delta of 0.95. So here the upper and the lower percentile that bound our statistic are not symmetric, so that C1 is minus C2. They are just different values. The confidence condition is the same. So the logic of the confidence condition is the same. The probability for the U statistic to take on values between C1 and C2 is delta by construction, because we evaluate C1 and C2 such that this is the case. And then we again have the case that u is a pivot, so our unknown expectation parameter is there, and this thing is a function of the data. So we can again reformulate this statement here by first inverting things. So multiply taking to the power of minus 1, and then isolating the sigma square and sandwiching it between these two upper and lower boundaries. And because this is just a reformulation of the confidence condition here, the probability for this lower boundary and this upper boundary to include sigma square is delta. Hence, we can also here write up the confidence interval as previously, and the probability for this confidence interval with this lower boundary and this upper boundary is then delta. So it's always the same logic, and it's once you get in there, it's actually straightforward, and you see the value of pivots, because you first need to make sure that this confidence condition is fulfilled, but this is fulfilled as soon as you know the distribution of the statistic. And then if it's a pivot, you can do this kind of reformulation, which then gives you a random lower boundary and a random upper boundary, such that the probability for sigma squared to be in there is exactly delta. Okay, so these were three examples for exact confidence intervals. We will see one more example in the exercise session. There we are dealing with the exponential distribution. And of course, these are also very common confidence intervals, so Z-statistic-based, T-statistic-based confidence intervals are the most common confidence intervals that you always see. But of course, the procedure is more general than only applicable to the Gaussian. Now, in the final 10 minutes, I want to show you the construction of approximate confidence intervals, which capitalizes on the asymptotic estimator theory that we established last time, specifically with respect to maximum likelihood estimators and the fact that they are asymptotically normally distributed and asymptotically efficient. The construction here is exactly the same. So the confidence intervals for approximate in the approximate case are of course constructed in exactly the same way as for exact confidence intervals. The only difference is that we have that we use statistics that are only asymptotically distributed according to a known distribution. And approximate confidence intervals are of course readily established for maximum likelihood parameter estimators based on the theory that we have, and one maximum likelihood estimator that we've seen previously that has an asymptotic normal distribution is of course the Bernoulli distribution parameter estimator. So let's look at exemplary approximate confidence intervals. So the logic is again as previously. So we assume that we have a random sample of a parametric statistical model, and we want to develop a delta confidence interval for theta. And now we don't have any Gaussian assumptions, but we have the assumption that we have a maximum likelihood estimator. We now consider the wall statistic with the expected Fisher information, which of course depend on the data by means of the maximum likelihood estimator, and also depends on the true but unknown parameter theta here. And we have seen previously that this expected that this wall statistic is asymptotically normally distributed according to a standard normal distribution. And as I said, it's a function of theta, while its asymptotic distribution does not depend on theta. So it's just the standard normal, but theta doesn't play a role. And this is, of course, then an approximate pivot. To construct now a confidence interval for a maximum likelihood estimator, it's exactly the same logic as for example, the Gaussian with the known variance parameter, because we're also dealing here with a statistic that is here in this case asymptotically, but in this case is also standard normally distributed. So we again select upper and lower boundaries based on the inverse CDF, such that the probability for our statistic to fall between these two boundaries is exactly delta. So in the limit of large samples, so the probability for the Wald statistic to be between the two percentiles minus Z2 and Z2, where Z2 is defined as the inverse of the CDF at 1 plus delta divided by 2, asymptotically goes to delta for n going to infinity. Hence, we can also, hence also the probability, this probability, which is just given by replacing the Wald statistic by its definition, is also going to delta for n going to infinity. And here again, then we can, that's a typo here, we want to sandwich the true but unknown parameter value. So, and this is why it's also again desirable to have a pivot, because then it depends on the true but unknown parameter value. So we first put the square root of the Fisher information on the other side, then we put the maximum likelihood estimator on the other side, and then we remove this minus sign, and then rewrite this statement here, that this asymptotically goes to delta by this statement here. So the maximum likelihood estimator minus the square root of the expected Fisher information at the location of the maximum likelihood estimator times that 2 as the lower boundary, and the parallel thing as the upper boundary, these two boundaries to enclose mu, this probability goes to delta for n to infinity. And hence we can formulate a confidence interval for a maximum likelihood estimator based on the lower boundary given by the maximum likelihood estimator minus the square root of its expected Fisher information times z delta, and the upper boundary given by the maximum likelihood estimator plus the the reciprocal of the expected Fisher information times z delta. And z delta we just get, of course, from the inverse CDF of the standard normal distribution. Then the probability for this confidence interval to cover theta goes to delta for n going to infinity. And so this works whenever you have a, this works in the limit of large samples whenever you have a maximum likelihood estimator. And what you require for that is, of course, the maximum likelihood estimator. You require the expected Fisher information, and you require the respective percentiles of the standard normal distribution. Now, in a concrete scenario, you need, of course, to evaluate the expected Fisher information. So here is a concrete scenario where we have the Bernoulli distribution parameter, maximum likelihood estimator, given by the sample mean. Then one can show that a 95% confidence interval for mu is given by mu hat ml minus 1.96, that's because we're dealing with a 95% confidence interval, times the square root of mu l hat times 1 minus mu l hat divided by n. And this holds because the z for 0.95 is 1.96, as we've seen previously, and because the expected Fisher information is at the maximum likelihood estimator is given by n divided by mu hat ml times 1 minus mu hat ml. And of course, this is, you can write down this confidence interval once you know the expected Fisher information. And this we actually, I think Julius presented it last week, can be evaluated. I included the derivation again here. So we want to compute here the Fisher information for the expectation parameter of a Bernoulli distribution, and of course we need we want to compute the expected Fisher information. For this we first need the Fisher information, which is the second derivative of the log likelihood function, which is evaluated for the Bernoulli distribution here, and then we compute its expectation and find that the expected Fisher information is 1 divided by mu times 1 minus mu. And there of course the problem is that we cannot use this for a confidence interval straight away, because we don't know mu, and here the expected Fisher information depends on mu. So we need an estimate for this expected Fisher information, or we need an observation of this expected Fisher information if you want, and we get this by substituting the maximum likelihood estimator in there. And once we have that, once we substitute that, then we have our observed expected Fisher information as n divided by the maximum likelihood estimator times 1 minus the maximum likelihood estimator. So then substituting the expected Fisher information in the general formula for approximate confidence intervals for maximum likelihood estimator yields this confidence interval for the Bernoulli distribution. And again, the construction is the same. The only difference is that these confidence intervals, they only work in the large sample size limit, but on the other hand, they work for all maximum likelihood estimators, which is a good thing. So whenever you have a parametric statistical model and you derive a maximum likelihood estimator, then based on the properties of maximum likelihood estimators that we established last week, you can always construct these approximate confidence intervals. So you can whenever you do maximum likelihood estimation, you get confidence intervals in a way for free if you are able to evaluate the expected Fisher information. Good. So that was essentially four times the same approach in terms of constructing confidence intervals. So make sure you understand it once and you're happy with it once, then the rest follows fairly naturally, or is it just the application of the same thing again. In the exercise session, we want to look a little bit into this question, why the t statistic has a t distribution. So basically by showing that the t statistic conforms to a standard normal random variable divided by the square root of a chi-square random variable divided by its degrees of freedoms, then one of your colleagues will present the construction of another 95% confidence interval, in this case for the parameter of an exponential distribution, to have a look at another example. And then I guess I will present a little bit of a weird example that tries to bring home the message that confidence intervals are not credible intervals, so they are not probability statements about true but unknown parameter values. So we don't discuss the probability for a true but unknown parameter value to do something, or for parameter value to do something, but we're discussing the probabilities for confidence intervals to do something, namely contain the true but unknown parameter value. And this is based on a somewhat weird example, but it's fun, let's say. So these are the theoretical exercises, and then maybe more importantly, we will look at some simulations of 95% confidence intervals, which bring home the interpretation again, so that in 95% of the cases, this confidence interval actually covers the true but unknown parameter value. Okay, so that's it from my side for today. So we start again with the exercise session, and the presentations in the exercise session at 1 o'clock. Are there any questions right now?
So, like in Confidence interval calculation, you use different statistic, like one time you use Z, one time U, and one time Walt.
Yep.
So like, is there any way like we can decide like which one we should use?
Yeah, that's a good question. So well, if you construct a confidence interval, you need a statistic that is a pivot. So you need to have a statistic that somehow comprises the expectation, or the parameter, the true but unknown parameter for which you want to construct a confidence interval. And it, yeah, of course, it should depend on the data. And this is the hardest part, to find these pivots, is actually to find statistics, the distributions of which are independent of the true but unknown parameter, right? So if you, for example, think of the sample mean, of course, the sample mean, the distribution of the sample mean in a Gaussian model depends on the true but unknown parameter, but then of course you can remove dependencies on the true but unknown parameter by putting it into your statistics. So yeah, to find statistics that fulfill that, well, of course, usually you will start with some kind of summary statistics that like sample means or variances, and then you need to have a look at in a given parametric statistical model what's the distribution of these summary statistics, and can I somehow change the summary statistic, which is of course just what happens, for example, in the Z statistic. So if you think of the Z statistic, what's happening in the Z statistic is that you start with the sample mean, and then you know that this is Gaussian distributed and it has variance, the true but unknown variance parameter divided by n, and then you want to make sure that the sample mean, in a way, you want to make sure that the distribution of the sample mean does not depend on the true but unknown parameters anymore, and you do that by factoring in the true but unknown parameters into this descriptive statistic. So I guess that's an approach how you can set out if you first invent your own probability distribution, and then you want to do confidence intervals for parameter estimates, how you can get started. The other approach is, of course, to just rely on maximum likelihood estimation, because then you don't need to find any statistics yourself. Essentially, you just start with your maximum likelihood estimator, study that a little bit, find the expected Fisher information, and then you already have everything. Okay, then I suggest we stop here and start again at 1 p.m. for the exercises. Goodbye. Okay, then let's finish today's session on confidence intervals with some final considerations on confidence intervals. And the first one being here framed as a theoretical exercise. By means of example, show that a confidence interval is not a probability statement about a true but unknown parameter value, or a true but unknown parameter. And of course, that's true already by construction, and in principle, there's nothing that really needs to be shown there. I mean, that's in the construction, the probability, and is with respect to the confidence interval, its upper and lower boundary, and the distribution is with respect to the confidence interval and not with respect to the parameter. So that's clear from the outset of the construction of a confidence interval. However, one can construct somewhat weird examples that also show a little bit the weirdness of frequentist statistics. So that's now an example after we've seen a couple of examples where one would say intuitively, yes, that seems to make some sense. If I report as my estimate for the true but unknown parameter this confidence interval, then if I would do that 100 times, my confidence interval that I report will actually include the true but unknown parameter in 95% of the cases, so almost all the time. So my confidence interval is yeah, useful as it covers the true but unknown parameter most of the time. So if I report it, the reader and myself can be fairly certain that the true but unknown parameter is actually somewhere between the boundaries of my confidence interval. So that it makes some intuitive sense, like a frequentist statistic makes some intuitive sense, but in frequentist statistics you can of course also always create kind of weird examples where it's a little bit unclear what this is about. And one of these weird examples that then of course also motivates things like the likelihood principle, which is kind of at the heart also of Bayesian statistics, is in the Wassermann book, and that's from this book by Berger, the likelihood principle. It's the first example in that book. So let's have a look at it. It's a little bit weird, but in the end it makes some sense. So what is happening in this example is that one is concerned with a interesting random variable that has an outcome space which depends on the parameter. And that's of course already under Fisher regularity conditions, that's something that should not be the case. And I didn't really follow up on that, whether that this thing turns out to be a little bit weird, and the confidence interval be be a little bit weird in this case, whether that is solely due to the fact that the parameter space is depending on the true but unknown parameter. But definitely that's not the best way to start in frequentist statistics if your true but unknown parameter determines the parameter space. In this example it nevertheless is, and the outcome space of the random variable is the true but unknown parameter theta minus 1 and the true but unknown parameter theta plus 1 for some real value theta. And then we assume that we have a distribution on this outcome space which assigns 1/2 to each possible outcome. So the probability that a random variable x takes on the value theta minus 1 on this outcome space is 1/2, and the probability that it takes on the other value, so theta plus 1, is also 1/2. Now we consider a random sample from this distribution, which comprises just two observations, so x1 and x2, distributed according to this probability mass function on this outcome space. And we consider a confidence interval that is constructed as follows. It's the interval from 1/2 x1 plus x2 to 1/2 x1 plus x2 if x1 does not equal x2, and it's the interval from x1 minus 1 to x1 minus 1 if x1 equals x2. These are of course interesting intervals, as they only contain one point. Yeah? So the upper and lower boundary of this interval are the same. These are intervals, but of course intervals that only contain one point. And then you have also this if statement here, so that the confidence intervals depends, or what you evaluate as confidence interval depends on your observations. Of course that's always the case. I mean, if you think of the confidence intervals that we looked at so far, of course the values that you sample determine the confidence interval, but not usually then in a kind of a continuous manner, and not with these if clauses. In any case, if you define things like that, then C is a 0.75 confidence interval for theta. So the probability that C covers theta is 0.75, and the probability that C does not cover the probability that C does not cover theta is 0.25. And I don't find this immediately clear. So why this thing here, this C, which I says 56, is a 0.75 confidence interval. You also notice that this was definitely not constructed according to the Ostwaldsche four-step procedure, but it just was written down and it was claimed that this is a 0.75 confidence interval. So I first wanted to clarify for myself why this is a 0.75 confidence interval. And this is what I want to do next. To see that this is actually, that this kind of construction here is a 0.75 confidence interval for theta, I first rewrite this confidence interval in terms of sets. Of course, any confidence interval is a set, it's a subset of the real numbers. And here I write, rewrite this interval from 1/2 x1 plus x2 to 1/2 x1 plus x2 as the set that contains the point 1/2 x1 plus x2. If of course, like here, if x1 equal does not equal x2, and I rewrite this interval from x1 minus 1 to x1 minus 1 as the point or the set containing only the point x1 minus 1. This just makes the notation a little bit more concise and is also clearer, because intervals with the same upper and lower boundaries, they are just points, so just can just write them like that. That is just kind of simplifying the notation a bit. And then I try to figure out there what's going on. And yeah, consider the different possible outcomes of these random variables, the statistics, because we have here two statistics that are of interest, namely this 1/2 x1 plus x2 and x1 minus 1. And whether or not yeah, these the resulting confidence intervals then cover the true but unknown value or not. So let's go step by step. So x1, so we have two random variables, and each random variable has the outcome set theta minus 1 and theta plus 1. So in principle, and probabilities are 1/2, so it's not that any of these outcomes are impossible. So x1 can come out theta minus 1, and x2 can also come out theta minus 1. x1 can come out theta minus 1, and x2 theta plus 1. And then, of course, x1 can come out theta plus 1, and x2 theta minus 1, and both of them can come out theta plus 1. So what then about our statistics? There are two statistics of interest. I start with the simpler one, if you want, so x1 minus 1. What is x1 minus 1 for these? So there are, so to reiterate this, the joint outcome space of x1 and x2 has four elements, namely theta minus 1, theta minus 1, theta minus 1, theta plus 1, theta plus 1, theta minus 1, and theta plus 1, theta plus 1. These are all possible combinations of the outcomes of x1 and x2. Now, what about the statistics computed on these on this outcome space? The first statistic of interest is x1 minus 1. So what do we get if we consider these four possible outcomes of x1 and x2? Well, the statistic is obviously only concerned with the outcome in the first component, so x1. So x1 minus 1 is, if theta is, sorry, if x1 is theta minus 1, then x1 minus 1 is theta minus 2. And the same here for theta minus 1. If the outcome of x1 is theta plus 1, then the statistic x1 minus 1 results in theta. So we have the statistic values corresponding to these data values. So in analogy, you can see this as these. So if you think about n samples from a random, n samples from a univariate Gaussian, then x1 and x2 would be two univariate Gaussians, and then the statistic would, for example, be the sample mean, and we just wrote up all values. Of course, for the outcomes of univariate random variables, you would have the real numbers times the real numbers, so you would have to write a lot. But so that's the analogy. So that's the first statistic, and the second statistic is given by 1/2 x1 plus x2. So again, we're considering all possible outcomes of our random variables. If x1 is theta minus 1 and x2 is theta minus 1, then we have here 2 theta minus 2, and we take 1/2, so the statistic takes on the value theta minus 1. If the outcomes are theta minus 1 and theta plus 1, then we have 2 theta in here, so the statistic takes on the value theta. Same if the signs are different, so the outcome is theta. And if both of them are theta plus 1, then we have 2 theta plus 2 in the brackets, take 1/2, and we have theta plus 1. So these are the values of the two statistics of interest that correspond to the all possible outcomes of these two random variables. Now, our confidence interval is dependent on whether x1 and x2 are identical or not, and so the outcomes are identical, and of course the identical outcomes here are theta minus 1 and theta minus 1 for x1 and x2, and theta plus 1 and theta plus 1 for x1 and x2. So these are the identical ones. So in this case, we take the first statistic, and the confidence interval corresponds to the point x1 minus 1, so that's then the confidence interval. In the case if it's theta minus 1 and theta plus 1, so if the two outcomes are different, then we take the other confidence interval. So what does this confidence interval evaluate to? Well, we have seen that already. It's this statistic, theta minus 2. So our confidence interval is theta minus 2, and this of course is just one point, and theta minus 2 is different from theta, so our theta here is not in the confidence interval, or in other words, the confidence interval, so this random variable does, and the value of this random variable here, that's why I use a small c, does not cover the true but unknown value, because the confidence interval is the point theta minus 2, which is not the same as theta. Now, if the two outcomes are different, we are supposed to take this, and the values that this confidence interval takes on is theta. So this confidence interval then covers the true but unknown value, and theta is in the confidence interval. Finally, if both outcomes are identical, but the outcomes are theta plus 1, then we have as confidence interval again x1 minus 1, and x1 is theta plus 1, so the confidence interval, the single point, is theta. So again, the confidence interval covers the true but unknown value. And now you might also appreciate why this is then by construction a 0.75 confidence interval. So we've seen we have four possible outcomes here. Of course, each of these outcomes has a probability of 1/4 to occur, because each of these outcomes has 1/2 to occur, and they are independent. To now evaluate the probability that the confidence interval covers the true but unknown parameter, I simplify things a little bit by considering 1 minus the probability that the confidence interval does not cover theta. And that's of course 1 minus, so that because this is here only one case, so we don't have to add anything. And this is then 1 minus the probability that x1 is theta minus 1 and x2 is also theta minus 1. The probability, the joint probability of both of them being theta minus 1, because each of them is 1/2 to be theta minus 1, is 1/2 times 1/2, so 1/4. So the probability that the confidence interval covers theta is 0.75. So far I just shown you that this construction is actually a 0.75 confidence interval in the books, and so this is kind of what Wassermann and Berger write up. It's easy to see that this is a 0.75 confidence interval. Yes, it's not hard to see, but one has to think a little bit about it. At least that's what I found. But then, C covers theta in this construction in 0.75% of the cases. But that doesn't address the weirdness yet. The weirdness comes in once you do the following. We assume that we made the observation x1 equals 15 and x2 equals 17. Then we have the case that our two variables are different, and as one of them is 15 and the other one is 16, we can 17, sorry, one of them is 15, the other one is 17, we can readily infer that theta must be 16, because if theta is 16, then it's in principle possible that we observe 15 and 17. So we are, based on the observed data, we are certain, we know we have uniquely identified the true but unknown parameter as 16, because it cannot be anything else. But now our confidence interval, which is still a 0.75 confidence interval, is of course also 16, so the outcomes are different, and we take x1 plus x2 times 1/2, so our confidence interval is 16 as well, but by construction that's a 0.75 confidence interval only. So we have kind of a, so if you want, there is kind of a paradox here, that we know that the true but unknown parameter must be 16, but our confidence interval, which also contains the true but unknown parameter, remains a 0.75 confidence interval. But in some other thinking about this, so this is of course only a paradox if you somehow think that the confidence that the that the confidence levels are state probability statements about parameters, because yeah, clearly you have the probability that theta equals 16 being 1 here, you are certain that this is the case, although we didn't introduce a prior and so on, but a confidence interval never wants to make any claims about the probability distribution of a parameter. It just says that a confidence interval covers the true but unknown parameter in this and that probability, with this and that probability. So hence this confidence interval does not refer to a probabilistic statement about the parameter, because here it's clearly, so this is fairly clear here. On the other hand, it was never supposed to. So it's kind of a, I don't know about this example, it's a little bit of a rhetorical device to say here, so but now we are sure that the parameter is 16 and our confidence interval is still only a 0.75 confidence interval. Yes, but that's by construction. So it's the meaning of that. And then of course one should be fairly careful with yeah, interpreting the term confidence in any way. One should always be aware of that we are talking about the distributions of intervals to cover the distribution of intervals and the probabilities to cover true but unknown parameters. We are not talking about the probability of parameters to take on given values. These are different things. Okay, so that was this example with this somewhat weird confidence interval and this somewhat weird construction that where if you make two observations, you already know the true but unknown parameter value, and then you know the true but unknown parameter value, but you don't have a but your confidence interval is still not 100%. We will see credible intervals, which are statements about parameters given data. So the crucial point between credible intervals and confidence intervals are that one, of course, referred to the probability of data given parameter, although we don't really condition on parameters here because we don't model them as random variables, but still confidence intervals are statements about the distribution of data and functions of data, namely these confidence upper and lower confidence interval boundaries, whereas credible intervals in the Bayesian settings are statements about the probability of parameters given data, which of course require some marginal probabilities for parameters. But this is where we get to after hypothesis testing. Good, so that was this somewhat weird theoretical exercise that you find in books. Any questions about this? Okay, apparently not. So then let's go to the programming exercise, and that or two programming exercises, namely one for a 95% confidence interval for the expectation parameter of a Gaussian with unknown variance, and we want to show that this actually comprises the true but unknown expectation parameter in 95% of its realizations, or it covers the true but unknown expectation parameter in 95% of its realizations, and an approximate 95% confidence interval for the maximum likelihood estimator of a Bernoulli distribution. And yeah, so this then kind of drives home the intuition of confidence interval as a random entity that depends on the distribution of the data. So let's have a look at the code here. Maybe I zoom in a little bit. Where am I there? So the first thing, so that's program exercise two. The first thing is about the confidence interval for the expectation parameter of a Gaussian with unknown variance, and we of course have seen this and constructed it today, so that's the confidence interval that is based on the t distribution. So that's this confidence interval which we are now simulating, and let's see what's happening. So first, I'm fixing here the true but unknown expectation and variance parameters of the Gaussian sample to 2 and the variance to 1. I decide on a sample size. I use a low sample size so that we have something that is different from a standard normal distribution if we look at our statistic. And I'm fixing the confidence level to 0.95. And then I'm evaluating the percentile that corresponds to the value in the outcome space of the statistic, such that we can sandwich 95% of the probability mass between the negative and the positive of these values. So that's where I use the inverse CDF, which in Python is called PPF. In other programs like MATLAB, it's actually called ICDF, which is a little bit more meaningful. And I evaluate this at 1 plus delta divided by 2, so at in this case 0.975, so roughly 2.2 is what's coming out. This of course depends on the sample size, so that's exactly this term here. So again, this is why I didn't write any, or didn't put figures in there, but wrote it up explicitly so that you can actually translate this into code. Then I decide on how many samples to take, and what I want to do here is actually take or create or take 100 samples and create 100 confidence intervals, and then hope to see that 95 cases of these 100 cases the confidence interval covers the true but unknown parameter. That's just my am I using this? For plotting. This is just my simulation counter. So I run 100 simulation, and in each simulation I take a sample from of size n, so 12 samples from univariate Gaussian with expectation parameter mu and variance parameter sigma square, which here in Python you need to pass as the standard deviation. And then I compute the respective statistics that are necessary. So I compute the sample mean, I compute the sample standard deviation. Actually, do I? I'm missing a square root there. It still worked. No, that should be. Ah, yeah, of course it still works, sorry, because my variance is 1, so I was lucky. I have a bug in the code, but it didn't affect the results, because of course the square root in this case is the same as the value. So here now the corrected code, the sample standard deviation, so the square root of the variance with n minus 1. And then I define this other term here, gamma, just it's not really necessary. I wanted to check something there, that's why I defined that. But this is this term t delta times s divided by the square root of n. So that's what I define here. And then I compute the upper and lower bounds of the confidence interval. And then I check whether the confidence interval actually, better expresses, then I check whether the true but unknown expectation parameter is actually in between the lower and the upper bound of the confidence interval. And that's what I do. So let's see whether my new code also works. So mu in C, npmean mu in C, yeah, still works. And so here in 96 cases the confidence interval covered the true but unknown parameter, which I saved here just as a logical indicator, so 1 if it's in there, 0 if it's not in there. For visualization purposes I also consider cases where mu not in C, and then I plot it. So let's have a look at the plots. So this is a visualization. So that's the scenario. This is what I have evaluated. These are my confidence intervals. And this was on a previous iteration where the estimated coverage probability was 0.92. So there were 8 cases out of these 100 where the confidence interval did not cover the true but unknown parameter. And these I marked here with red. This is why I needed these cases where mu is not in there, so they can know these indices of these red dots. And what you see here are the confidence intervals. So the parameter spaces here on the y-axis, the simulations are on the x-axis, and you see on the first simulation the confidence interval comprises the true but unknown parameter 2. On the second simulation it covers it, on the third it covers it, and so on. So you see it covers it all the time. Here it's quite small, and here is one case where it does not cover the true but unknown parameter, and here's another. So there are, in this case there are 8 cases where it does not cover it, but of course these are only 100 simulations, and if you they'll run for more often, you will approximate of course the 0.95 more reliably. So let's look at a different case that I just ran. So here we have a case where the confidence interval covered the true but unknown parameter value in 94 of the 100 cases. Yeah, any questions regarding this simulation? Apparently not. And then the final exercise related to an approximate 95% confidence interval for the expectation parameter of a Bernoulli distribution. So this is then an implementation of this scenario here, which is a special case of the general confidence intervals or the general approximate confidence intervals for maximum likelihood estimators, which is based on the expected Fisher information and the asymptotic distribution, which is the standard normal distribution of this Wald statistic. So that's the confidence interval here that we ended up with. And yeah, let's look at the simulation. So here we are dealing with a Bernoulli distribution, so we have a true but unknown expectation parameter in the open interval 0, 1. So it's not a Gaussian in this case. Again, I'm taking 100 or do 100 samples. Again, I want a 95% confidence interval. Now I need the percentiles from the standard normal distribution, so with expectation parameter 0 and variance parameter 1, and yeah, again using the inverse CDF at 1 plus delta divided by 2, so that we divide the 0.05 probability to both sides of the central 95% probability mass. And yeah, then I'm using the n here, this sorry, I was confused, this is not my number of simulations, this is the sample size that I'm taking. And actually I can also show you that this approximate confidence interval doesn't work that well for small samples, unless I can show you in a second. This is my number of simulations, so again I wanted to have 100 simulations and see essentially that in 95 of these 100 simulations the confidence interval covers the true but unknown parameter. Yeah, and then here's the actual simulation. So I first take a sample of size n with the true but unknown expectation parameter mu. The maximum likelihood estimator here is of course the sample mean. So that's the maybe better denoted by a maximum likelihood estimator, and then the observed or if you want estimated expected Fisher information is mu hat times 1 minus mu hat divided by n, and based on that we can then already form the confidence interval and check whether the true but unknown parameter is within the lower and upper boundary of the confidence interval. For visualization we also have the cases that mu is not in C. So logic is the same as here. The difference is, of course, that we only need the maximum likelihood estimator here, and we build the confidence interval boundaries based on the expected Fisher information. If we looked at the visualization that I have here, we now are dealing with the two-bit unknown parameter 0.7, yeah. And again, I plot the confidence interval for each of the 100 simulations. And in this case, in four cases, the confidence interval did not cover the true but unknown parameter, but all the other times it did. But this was for 100 Bernoulli samples, so maybe let's have a look at what happens if we use a low sample size here. So now we only take 10 samples, or maybe let's actually take 12 samples as in the previous case. So that, because that worked quite well obviously for the normal, I could have comment the other one out. So let's look at this. Yeah, so here we now look at the probability estimate for coverage for 12 samples only, and there it's further away from the 95. We might make this more extreme because there's of course fluctuations also in these 100 simulations, but yeah, let's have a look. If we only take 5, so then we are really off. So these are approximate confidence intervals in the large sample limit, and if we are not in the large sample limit, then these confidence intervals are no good, right? So I mean, I think the most extreme would be if we, does that work, or do we get something weird? No, if we have only one, then we might run into trouble. Let's see what we get here. Yeah, then it's never in there. That's also nice. And maybe a little bit more realistic. So here we then have a coverage probability estimate of only 0.4. So these approximate confidence intervals, of course, they are asymptotic approximations. So for low sample sizes, and even for the sample size where the Gaussian works quite well, now we have again 92. Maybe that's even actually, we can actually prove something like that. How much the bias is? It seems to be around 90 for small sample sizes. But if we go to no, it's only around 80. So oops. If we now go to big N, let's get rid of this here. Then, but already in the case of 100, the confidence intervals have the approximate confidence intervals have the coverage probability that they should have. Good. Yeah, so these were two simulations implementing the confidence intervals that we discussed in the lecture. And that's it from my side for today. Are there any questions?
I have a question. The exercises, the practical exercises, when do we have a deadline for?
Yeah, that was included in the first lecture. So for the theoretical exercises, there's actually no deadline whatsoever. The theoretical exercises are just there for your pleasure and for doing them and learn more. There is a deadline for the programming exercises, so you should submit all programming exercises, and that deadline is at the end of the term. Actually, in the first lecture, I just looked up it up again today, it said 26th of March. For me, it's probably fine if it's 31st of March. I will send around an email regarding the exam soonish. I already did that in scan, because we will have to do the exam in a oral fashion, so there will be an oral exam, not a written exam as it's supposed to be because of the pandemic. And there I will include again the dates for submission of the programming exercise. But if you look at the first at the introduction, the first lecture, then you actually find all the information, except for the fact that it's still it was planned with a written exam and not an oral exam, which requires some modification. But as I said, I will send that around maybe this weekend, maybe early next week.
Okay, thank you. That's clear.
Okay, good. So, anything else? Okay, then we stop here. So today we discuss confidence intervals as one of the kind of less precise but more reliable estimates of parameters. So more reliable because you can be quite sure that you're doing something well there, in this sense that we discussed at length today. And next week we will in a way look at the other side of the coin of confidence intervals, which are hypothesis tests. And yeah, we will need the selective statistics that we introduced today as well. And then in the end of next week's lecture, see the equivalence between hypothesis tests and confidence intervals. Okay. Then let's stop here and see you next week at 7:30. Goodbye.